Good morning. Welcome to Law Talk with Ethel Mitchell. I'm your host, Attorney Ethel Mitchell, and I welcome all who are listening throughout the world on Radio 1, Station 1450 AM, WLDCnews.com, LawTalkWithEthelMitchell.com, and also over the free TuneIn app. This program is brought to you by my law office, Wills and Trust, LLC, where I prepare wills, trust, power of attorneys, and help people with administering estates. So if you or someone you know needs a will or help in administering an estate, call me at 202-772-1988. That's 202-772-1988. It's also brought to you by my sponsor, Equity Resources. If you want to sell your property in D.C., Maryland, or Northern Virginia, call Equity Resources. They will buy your property quickly for cash and at a reasonable price. So give them a call at 202-621-6632. As you hear me say every week, law is powerful. It can help you or it can hurt you. It impacts everything you do. What you don't know can hurt you, but what you do know can empower you. And our program this week is really about empowerment. We're going to be talking to you today about domestic abuse with our special guest, the Honorable Judge Fern Flanagan Sadler. But first, I must remind you that whatever you hear on this program is for information purposes only. No attorney-client relationship is established by anything said on this program. Each person's circumstances are different, and you must seek individual counsel for any situation for which you need legal advice. It's important to know your rights under the law, especially as it relates to domestic abuse. Domestic Violence Month is this month, and as it comes to a close, I want to share with you a few startling statistics from a recent Huffington Post article. Every day it seems that three women are murdered in the United States by a former male partner. Women with disabilities are 40% more likely to experience intimate partner violence, especially severe violence, more so than women who do not have disabilities. 4 million women experience physical violence by an intimate partner every year. 1,509 women were murdered in 2011 by a partner, an intimate partner. 926 of those were killed, and 264 of those were killed during an argument. It is just a frightening statistic that there's so much violence in our society, and particularly among people who are former or current intimate partners. And it's not restricted to women. As Judge Sadler will tell us, a lot of men are the victims of violence as well. One in four women are victims of violence. One in seven men become victims of violence with an intimate partner. 40% of the women in a physically abusive relationship have been raped or assaulted during the relationship. There are just gay and bisexual men, 2 in 5 of them will experience violence in their lifetimes. 50% of lesbian women will experience violence in their lifetimes from intimate partners. 81% of the women who are stalked by a current or former male partner are also physically abused by that person. So this is a huge, huge problem in our society. And it is one of the areas where the law can really help to empower you and can really do something to stop what's going on. And that, of course, will make everyone feel a lot better and their lives be so much better. I am very, very pleased to welcome Judge Fern Flanagan Sadler this morning. She was appointed a judge in 2003 to the Superior Court of the District of Columbia. She earned her Bachelor's of Art degree from Wellesley College in Massachusetts and her Juris Doctorate degree from Georgetown University Law Center in Washington, D.C. She worked as an attorney at a general practice law firm before she became assistant bar counsel for the District of Columbia. She then served as senior staff attorney for the District of Columbia Court of Appeals. From 1991 until 2003, she was a magistrate judge in the Superior Court of the District of Columbia, and in that capacity, she presided over thousands of matters in the criminal, civil, and family divisions of the court. In 2010, she was assigned to the Domestic Violence Unit of the Superior Court of the District of Columbia and has served in both the civil and the criminal divisions of the Domestic Violence Unit. Thank you, Judge Sadler, for being on this program, and welcome.
Good morning, and thank you for inviting me to be here, particularly during Domestic Violence Awareness Month.
Yes, thank you very much. So let's get started. Let's first talk about who can bring a domestic violence complaint. Who does that? What do you have to be?
The person who brings a domestic violence complaint is called a petitioner. In other words, they're petitioning or asking for something. They are the alleged victim of abuse.
Okay. Okay.
In the District of Columbia, a petitioner or victim who lives, works, attends school in D.C. can bring a complaint for domestic violence, as can a petitioner who is in the legal custody of a District of Columbia agency.
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, that would be somebody or could be somebody in the care of foster care.
Okay.
As an example.
Very good.
Lastly, if the underlying offense occurred in the District of Columbia, then an alleged victim can bring a case in the District of Columbia. So, for example, a person... Mm-hmm. Who lives in Maryland or Virginia.
I was about to ask you,
But who is the alleged victim of an offense that occurred in D.C. can bring a case here.
Okay, that's good to know.
So those are the three instances.
That's good to know. So you don't have to live in D.C. in order to bring the case in D.C. As long as it either occurred here, or you go to school here, you work here, or you are in some way connected with D.C., it's allowed for you to bring the case here in D.C.
That is correct. There also must be what's called a protected relationship.
Okay, so what does that mean? Explain that to me.
Well, that means, and there are a lot of categories there, but not only must you meet the first test of either living, working, attending school here, or having the offense occur here, or being a part of an agency. In the District of Columbia where there's legal custody, there also must be a relationship by either of the following, by blood. So there's a blood relationship with the alleged abuser, and that would include parents, children, siblings, aunts, uncles, and grandparents.
Okay.
Next, there could be a marriage or domestic partnership.
Okay.
And I want to stress this includes both current and former marriages and domestic partnerships.
That's good to know. That's good for people to know. Yes.
And it also includes in-laws, step-parents, step-children, and step-siblings.
Okay.
Okay. Third, there can be, as I stated, legal custody such as foster care. Another we call it statutorily protected relationships, is having a child in common.
Okay, whether you're married or not.
Whether you're married or not.
Very good.
A child in common with that person.
Mm-hmm.
The next one is sharing a residence, and it's on the form, on the protection order, it says now or used to share the same residence.
Okay.
And that it can include, for example, roommates in a boarding house.
Okay, people in a rooming house.
Correct.
Yeah,
or
very
a shelter.
Good.
We see
who
a lot
are
of
not who are not related any other way.
Not related at all.
Okay.
They just share living space.
Okay. That's good.
Like
for
a shelter.
To know.
And we do look, though, to whether they share in that rooming house common areas of the house, mm-hmm. like a kitchen or bathroom.
Right.
Because we want to protect against potential landlords.
Just trying to get rid of people.
Who might claim that they're the victim of domestic violence, but okay. So we want to make sure they share common
They actually
areas.
Share. Right, yes. Right. So, and people like that who are roommates, they don't have to be in an intimate relationship.
Not at all.
Okay.
They don't have to be in any relationship at all, except they now or used to share the same residence.
Okay, okay.
Okay, next is that... you have to, it could be a stalking situation. And in that case, having been allegedly stalked by the respondent, it doesn't require any relationship of any kind, family or romantic.
Okay, that's good for people to know.
Yes.
Doesn't have to be sexual. Doesn't It can be, but it doesn't have to be.
Can be total strangers.
All right,
okay,
that's good.
So no romance required or anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
And that's very different.
Yeah, that would be different. That would be different. Yeah, yeah.
Another thing is being or having been sexually abused by the alleged abuser. And, of course, this doesn't require a romantic or family relationship either.
Okay, good, good. In terms of age, tell me a little bit about the age. Are there any age restrictions or requirements that a person who is an alleged victim has to meet? Do they have to be at least a certain age?
Well, let me just say this. What we see generally is that we have adult alleged victims.
Right, usually.
For the most part.
Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't mean that minors don't have rights either.
Okay.
For example, minors are explicitly permitted to file for protection orders pursuant to what's called the Intrafamily Offense Act.
Mm-hmm.
And so they can pursue a civil protection order. Let me just say this, a parent, guardian, or custodian, or any other appropriate adult may file on behalf of the minor.
Okay.
Okay, and there are situations, too, where minors who are at least 16 years old may file on their own behalf.
Okay, that's good to
now,
know.
Now, minors who are less than 16 may file, but only if a parent, guardian, or custodian files on their behalf.
On their behalf.
Except
if they're in an intimate relationship. Yes.
And except that for children who are at least 12 years old,
mm-hmm.
and who are in an intimate
relationship, they can file on their own without their parents.
They can file for a temporary protection order,
right.
In their own behalf.
Okay,
a judge may look to see if a guardian ad litem
can be appointed.
Yes, in that instance.
In that instance.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
When we come right back, we'll talk about the kinds of activities that are punishable and how the proceedings take place.
Okay.
Thank mm-hmm. you very much. We have to take a break.
1450 WOL, where information is power.
News1.com is breaking news for Black America. News1.com tells the stories we care about. Our community, our concerns, our world. Uncensored, unapologetic. News One is news from our perspective. One people, one voice. News1.com.
Is your well water staining your toilets, sinks, and clothes? Does your water smell and taste bad? End these problems with HydroCare's revolutionary well water system. Get clean, healthy, great-tasting water in every faucet. HydroCare removes high levels of iron, hydrogen sulfide, sediment, and many other contaminants that are distasteful and damaging your fixtures. Unlike other expensive complex systems, HydroCare's multi-stage well water system costs only $849. Doesn't require any tanks, backwashing, or electricity. You'll love the way your water tastes, smells, and looks. Try now, pay later. HydroCare, the smart technology for all your water problems.
Go to cleanwater411.com. That's cleanwater411.com. You'll be amazed how fresh and clean well water can be. cleanwater411.com.
Revolution in clean water is here. HydroCare.
If your child is choking, stand behind them and wrap your arms around their waist. Place the thumb side of your fist against their upper abdomen. Put your other hand over the fist. Now press the fist into your child's abdomen with a quick inward and upward thrust. Repeat quick thrusts until object and airway.
You know how to help your child if they're choking, but do you know how to help them if they have a drug problem? Visit drugfree.org for information, help, and advice.
A message from the partnership at drugfree.org and Prevention First.
Geico presents Strange Savings Stories. Sam Tucker woke to find crop circles in his cornfield that spelled out the word Geico. Was this a message sent by aliens? Sam went to Geico.com and saved hundreds of dollars with great discounts. He woke the next day to find new crop patterns had formed. They spelled out, "You the man." It seems the aliens were pleased indeed.
Geico. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance.
HelloBeautiful.com is the website for today's black woman.
Whether you follow the power moves of Michelle Obama and Oprah,
or just want to keep up with the Braxtons and Basketball Wives.
Whether you need some help with your outfit,
or if you want to clown on someone else's.
Hello Beautiful is helpful hints and guilty pleasures.
Hello Beautiful keeps you connected and gives you a break.
For every part of you, HelloBeautiful.com.
Owning and caring for a home comes with a lot of to-dos. Fix the AC, build a deck, remodel the kitchen. Whatever your home improvement need, Home Advisor can help you find a pro you can trust to get the job done right. Go to fixitfast.homeadvisor.com for instant access to top-rated pros in your area, including electricians, handymen, remodelers, whatever type of home pro you need. Home Advisor is absolutely free to use. At Home Advisor, you don't have to search through a long list of pros. With just a few clicks, Home Advisor matches you with pros who provide the exact services you need. You can read customer reviews of the pros, even use the cost guide to find out what hundreds of other home projects cost in your area. And because Home Advisor knows it's important to find a pro you can trust in your home, they conduct background checks on their service professionals. It's just one of the reasons more than 25 million homeowners have used Home Advisor. Go to fixitfast.homeadvisor.com to find the right pro for your project. That's fixitfast.homeadvisor.com.
News Talk 1450 WOLAM, where information is power.
Welcome back. You're listening to Law Talk with Ethel Mitchell. I'm your host, Attorney Ethel Mitchell. And we have with us today Judge Fern Flanagan Sadler from the District Court of the Superior Court of Washington, D.C., the Domestic Violence Unit. And she is educating us about what kind of relief, who can file, and what kind of relief is available for victims of domestic violence. So, Judge, if you would tell us what kinds of behavior are punishable, and what, you know, there's a lot of misconception out there about, you know, what you have to put up with and what you don't, and how you bring your case and so on. Could you tell us a bit about that, please?
Yes. Well, first of all, let me just explain that the Domestic Violence Unit is a division of the Superior Court, and we have two sides to that, the criminal side and the civil side.
Okay.
And so a alleged victim can bring a case on either side.
On either side.
If it's the criminal side, it means they've called the police and a prosecutor has decided to pursue a criminal case.
Okay.
On the civil side, it is the alleged abuser who's coming in saying, "I want a protection order." And so they can first, before they get the civil protection order, which lasts for a period not to exceed a year, they can first get a temporary protection order.
Okay.
And that lasts for 14 days. They're given that. And they can then await getting the civil protection order.
The civil protection order.
Now, we see, I'm going to talk about a little of the typical offenses we see.
Okay. Let's
anything that's punishable as a crime.
Right.
And the intrafamily offense. Situation exists, they can file about. So it can be anything from arson, destruction of property, theft, parental kidnapping, all just to name a very few.
Right.
But typically we see, the audience should probably remember the acronym HATS, harassing, assaulted, threatening, or stalking behavior.
Oh, very good.
And so as to simple assault, we see that quite a bit.
Mm-hmm.
I think this can include, for example, shoving, pushing, kicking, slapping somebody. But one misconception I think that many of the alleged victims have is, or abusers believe, is mm-hmm. that it just involves pushing, kicking, hitting.
Mm-hmm.
But simple assault can involve a whole lot more than that.
Such
For
as?
Example, if you spit at somebody throw some liquid at them, that can constitute
That's punishable.
Assault. Yes, that's punishable. And many of our litigants don't realize that.
Don't realize that, yeah.
Okay, as to threats, in this technologically advanced society,
mm-hmm.
it not only means one-on-one, a verbal threat to harm, and by the way, it's a threat to do bodily harm.
Right, right.
So, for example, it would not include a threat to take somebody to court.
Right, that's right, right.
What's
that's
complicated.
Not, right.
It's
a threat, right.
It's a threat to do bodily harm.
Uh-huh.
But one thing I think about a misconception is that many of the respondents or alleged abusers think that they have to mean what they say, in other words.
Mm-hmm.
But if you just say something, and it could be either verbally, say through a text message, phone conversation.
Okay.
But if you say it, and if a reasonable person, having heard those words you mm-hmm. said, think mm-hmm. that they would be harmed.
Either.
You do not have to be physically hit.
That's important for you to know. You don't have to have a bruise. You don't have to have a scar.
That's correct.
Okay.
Uh-huh. And so you'll see a lot of the alleged abusers saying, yeah, but she didn't have any scars or didn't go to the hospital.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that might be something the judge would look at, but it's not required to constitute the...
The action, right.
The action
right.
assault.
So if somebody threatens you with bodily harm, even verbally?
Yes.
Through a text message, mm-hmm. on the internet?
Yes.
That could be grounds for coming into court.
Yes, on both either the criminal side or the civil
protection
order
side. Or the
civil side.
Okay.
And there are instances where an alleged victim is on both sides.
I see.
They have a criminal case as a complaining witness, and then they have taken out or requested a civil protection order.
A civil protection order.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And one thing that you've told me also in other situations is a lot of times it's family members living in the family house
that
are fighting and fussing and, I mean, not just fussing, but fighting and really hurting each other.
Surprisingly, we see a lot of siblings. And when I say siblings, I'm not talking about little people. I'm talking about
adult,
big people who might be living in their deceased mother or father's home.
Uh-huh.
And they're just not getting along.
Uh-huh.
And so it might ultimately end up in some type of assault or threat.
Wow.
And they can be brought into
the
domestic
into
violence unit.
Okay.
Yes.
Very good.
And
very
I was surprised
good.
To see that.
Yeah.
Because a lot of time we think it's just men and women.
Yes.
But it's siblings and
you also said this
love.
Morning that there is no longer a stigma. The courthouse is full of people, and there are a lot of men who are seeking protective orders as well.
Absolutely.
That's good to know.
I see a good number of men who come in as alleged victims.
Victims, as victims,
and,
yes.
And they're bringing cases against maybe their child's mother or somebody they're romantically involved with.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not only women who are bringing these cases against others, men or whomever, but it's men too.
It's also men too.
And sometimes they have what's called cross petitions.
They
are each requesting against each
right,
other.
Right.
Yes.
Well, let's talk about that. How do you make a decision? How do you decide what kind of evidence, what kind of proof do people have to bring you to when they come before you in court?
Well, let's just say this is a case that ends up in a trial, and we do have some that ends up in a trial. Sometimes, as an aside, we first have a case where somebody is consenting to the entry of a civil protection order without admitting to the allegations in the petition.
Uh-huh.
So they're saying, I agree to stay away and have no contact with you,
mm-hmm.
but we have other cases where it's called an adjudicated hearing or trial. Now, what I need is very explicit testimony, and some of our litigants are self-represented, and so they're not quite sure how to present a case. But in a case, the petitioner or the alleged victim has to prove their case to the court by what's called good cause.
And how do they do that? How do they do that?
Well,
do you decide that?
Evidence, and I have to explain to them, they're sworn in, and once they're sworn in, their testimony can be used as evidence.
Okay.
And they might have documentary evidence. Some people bring their cell phones in to show me what was sent as a text.
Okay.
Or I can listen to what was possibly said by an alleged
that's
victim.
Good.
But that's all evidence. They can bring in witnesses. It's not required that they have witnesses, but many do have witnesses, and so each side gets to tell his or her side of the story. I encourage them to be very specific because words matter.
Right.
So, for example, I get people who say, "Well, this is an example. He called me out of my name," and that's a common term used.
Right, right.
And I absolutely know what that means.
He
called me out of my name.
Right.
But I have to say, sir or ma'am, you have to tell me the words they
said. Tell me the words that they
used.
So
I can determine if it was a threat or other offense. And so I encourage them to be very specific, and I tell them you can use bad words.
In this courtroom.
This is the domestic violence unit.
Right. I need to know what they said.
I know to need to know exactly
what
they said.
What they did.
They present their case, show good cause, I can enter the civil protection order, and then I can grant the relief.
You have a lot
requested.
Of relief that you can
There's
grant.
There's a lot of relief.
You have a lot
grant.
Of relief you can grant. You really do. Yeah.
So, for example, they may want a stay-away order, and it might I might order the abuser, alleged abuser, to stay away and have no contact. Stay maybe, usually it's 100 feet away from the person, home, workplace, vehicle. All of that can be requested.
Can be requested. You can order that.
I can order that. I can
right.
put that on the civil protection order. I can order that there be no contact, which means don't call, don't write, no emails, no text messages, nothing on the social internet, either directly or indirectly through a third party.
Okay.
So the alleged abuser can't get somebody else
to act on his or her behalf. Right.
Now, there can be exceptions. For example, couples who have children in common ask for an exception sometimes
to talk about the children
in common.
Or
talk about emergencies.
Yeah, that kind of thing.
Very good.
Thank you very much. We have to take one more break, and when we come back, we're going to talk a bit more about the kind of relief that you can grant. This is very good. Thank you so much. Thank
you. Welcome.
News updates on the web at WOLDCnews.com.
Now a credit repair tip from creditrepair.com.
Credit tip number one. Late payments are among the top causes of a lower credit score. But did you know that even after you pay them off, late payments remain on your credit report as a negative item that continues to hurt your score? Your credit score improves when those late payments are actually removed from your report. But it can be extremely difficult. That's why you need the credit experts at creditrepair.com. They work with both your creditors and the credit bureaus to remove questionable negative items from your report and improve your credit score.
If you're suffering from a low credit score, call creditrepair.com at 800-216-2994. And in just a few minutes, you'll know exactly what's hurting your credit score and how to improve it. For over 15 years, we've been helping thousands. So call creditrepair.com at 800-216-2994. 800-216-2994. 800-216-2994.
Health Markets Insurance Agency is a DBA or assumed name of InSphere Insurance Solutions Incorporated, licensed insurance agency in all states. Not all agents are licensed to sell all products. Service availability varies by state. An important message for Americans eligible for Medicare. The annual enrollment period is now open. Call 800-906-6586 to find the coverage that's right for you at the right price. That's 800-906-6586. Health Markets Insurance Agency offers thousands of plans nationwide and can help you find the right plan with one simple free phone call. Speak with a licensed insurance agent and review your Medicare options at no cost or obligation. The deadline is December 7th. Choose your 2015 Medicare plan today. Put our free service to work for you at no charge. Call 800-906-6586. 800-906-6586. That's 800-906-6586.
Hi, my name is Stanley, and I've been arrested for stealing shoes. I didn't really steal them, but I've been sent to Camp Green Lake anyway. The worst punishment a kid could get. And at Camp Green Lake, we dig holes. Lots of holes. I've only been here a short time, but I think the camp director is up to something. I'm Stanley Yelnats, and I'm covering more than dirt at Camp Green Lake. Explore new worlds. Read my story in the novel Holes by Lewis Sacker. For other great book ideas, visit your local library or log on to literacy.gov. Brought to you by the Library of Congress and the Ad Council.
Owning and caring for a home comes with a lot of to-dos. Tune up the furnace, clean the gutters, remodel the kitchen. Whatever your home improvement need, Home Advisor can help you find a pro you can trust to get the job done right. Go to fixitfast.homeadvisor.com for instant access to top-rated pros in your area, including electricians, handymen, plumbers, whatever type of home pro you need. And Home Advisor's absolutely free to use. At Home Advisor, you don't have to search through a long list of pros. With just a few clicks, Home Advisor matches you with pros who provide the exact services you need. You can read customer reviews of the pros, even use the cost guide to find out what hundreds of other home projects cost in your area. And because Home Advisor knows it's important to find a pro you can trust in your home, they conduct background checks on their service professionals. It's just one of the reasons more than 25 million homeowners have used Home Advisor. Go to fixitfast.homeadvisor.com to find the right pro for your project. That's fixitfast.homeadvisor.com.
Ad Council.
News Talk 1450 WOL AM, where information is power.
Welcome back. You're listening to Law Talk with Ethel Mitchell. I'm your host, Attorney Ethel Mitchell, and I have with me in the studio Judge Fern Flanagan Sadler. She is with the Domestic Violence Unit of the Superior Court of Washington, D.C., and she's enlightening us on the law as it applies to domestic violence. Judge, one of the things that you've told me, and then we're going to get to the relief that you can give, is that the domestic violence unit is on the fourth floor.
Yes.
Of the Superior Court. Is that correct?
That's correct.
You can call 202-879-1010. That's the general number for the court?
Yes.
And they will be connected to the domestic violence unit?
They can be, yes.
Okay. And there is a whole division that will help people even prepare their papers.
Yes.
They're not lawyers, but they will help. They can't represent them.
That's correct. A very friendly staff, very helpful staff on the fourth floor. Persons, when they first come in to seek a protection order, can first ask for a temporary protection order.
Right.
And I do want to mention, by the way, that they can get that at the Superior Court, or if it's not convenient or traveling is an issue.
Uh-huh.
We also have a satellite office.
And where is that?
That's located in Southeast.
Uh-huh.
And they can go to the United Medical Center.
Okay.
In Washington, D.C.
Uh-huh.
And they can attempt to get a temporary protection order.
Right.
While they await a civil protection order. Now, interestingly enough, I can see them on the bench.
Wow.
Their picture is sent to me on a screen.
Wow.
I have that computer on the desk, and so I'm listening to them, and I can actually issue, or any judge can issue, a temporary protection order while they're at that satellite office.
That's important to know, and it's important, I think, for people to realize that for the temporary order, it can be done without the alleged abuser in court.
99% of the time.
That's
it
what I
is.
Thought. Okay.
It can be done with just the alleged victim there and the judge.
And the judge.
And the judge looks at whether the alleged victim's safety or welfare is endangered.
Endangered.
And it's a quick process. It's
okay.
Not long and drawn out.
Okay, that's important. And so if you know...
Cost is not a factor.
All of this is free. There is no cost. Also, Judge, I want people to know that if you are an immigrant and your papers are not in order, you can still come to court and get relief.
Is that correct? That's correct. A victim does not have to fear being deported or whatever, and we certainly want to encourage victims of domestic violence to come in and report about any abuse.
Any abuse,
so
right.
That is not an issue.
Okay, that's important for people to know.
And they'll be reported to the Immigration Customs Enforcement.
Good.
Yes.
And you have Spanish-speaking help.
We absolutely do. We have a wonderful court interpreter's office,
uh-huh.
And so anyone who does not speak English, we
uh-huh.
have the interpreter who can come to the court.
Okay, and not just
upon
Spanish.
Request, not just Spanish.
Almost any
many
language.
Many languages.
Okay,
yes.
That's good for the audience to know.
Yes.
That is very good to know.
Yes.
Okay, so there's the temporary order, and then there's the general civil order and, you know, protective order. What kind of relief can you grant? And if the person doesn't obey it, what can you do about it?
Well, I can grant a lot of relief for a civil protection order. If I've decided found that the victim has met his burden of proof,
uh-huh.
I can grant relief for the abuser to stay away and have no contact.
Mm-hmm.
I can grant custody on a temporary basis to either the victim or the abuser or both. But we certainly consider that the safety and welfare of the child is paramount and the best interest of the child.
Okay.
So I can do that. And a lot of times the custodian of the child has some input, too,
okay.
about what they might request. For example, they might want supervised visits only for the child.
And you can arrange that. You can help them arrange that.
I can do that, yes.
Very good.
After getting testimony.
Right.
I can also require the respondent to vacate a residence.
Even if they own it?
Even if they're, yes.
Okay.
In some instances. And
people need to know that.
Yes. And when there's joint ownership, a lot are of abusers are surprised to find they have to leave the residence.
Mm-hmm.
But if I found they have committed an intra-family offense, they can be asked to leave and vacate immediately. I can even have the police accompany the respondent to pick up any belongings they might want to get on a certain date.
Very good.
And most of the time I do order that the police accompany them to protect both the victim and the abuser, too.
Very
I can order child support.
Very good, right there.
Yes, I can order child support.
Uh-huh.
All the judges are well-versed in the child support guidelines.
Uh-huh.
And so I can do that. I can...
That's important because one of the statistics that Stacy gave me I wasn't able to announce was that financial abuse is very common. A lot of abusers use money to keep people under their thumb.
Yes, it's an issue of control. And I can also order that the abuser provide the victim with financial assistance in certain
mm-hmm.
amounts. It could be per month, one-time basis. It could be for rent or mortgage assistance,
mm-hmm.
Spousal support, property damage.
And you can take the
medical
money out
costs.
The paycheck, too, can't you?
Well, you need to. Well, particularly in child support, it can mm-hmm. be deducted from their paycheck.
Mm-hmm.
And so property damage is a big issue. For example, if during the incident, the alleged abuser throws somebody's cell phone on the floor and breaks it.
Mm-hmm.
I can order reimbursement for
reimbursement
that.
Okay,
if it's requested.
Uh-huh.
I can also order that there be possession and use of jointly owned property.
Mm-hmm.
For example, if a couple was living together,
mm-hmm.
they bought a vehicle together, but
mm-hmm.
she really needs that vehicle to transport the children.
Right.
I can
right.
order that type of relief. And also, just as importantly, I can require the abuser to enroll in and complete certain counseling programs.
Okay.
For example, I can order alcohol and drug abuse assessment.
Oh, that's important.
And treatment.
It's a lot of time that's an issue.
Deems
yeah.
it appropriate. I can order that they enroll in and complete the domestic violence intervention program
mm-hmm.
that's generally reserved for married people or people who've had some type of romantic dating relationship
mm-hmm.
or are married, or the family violence intervention program,
mm-hmm.
which is generally reserved for people who are related by blood.
Okay. And how long are those programs?
The domestic violence intervention program, we call it DVIP, is a 22-week program.
Very good.
And they have to be drug-free. This is in the District of Columbia. They
right.
have to be drug-free before they can enroll
they can
in that
in.
Program.
Right.
And so and the same for the Family Violence mm-hmm. Intervention Program.
Mm-hmm.
Our probation office, known as Court Services Offender Supervision Agency, uh-huh. monitors our civil protection orders.
And what does that mean?
It means that when special conditions are ordered by a judge,
mm-hmm.
the respondent has to go in, enroll in, and complete the program. And when they do not complete it mm-hmm. As directed by the judge, we often get notice from the probation office.
And what can you do then? If somebody, because some of these people can be really recalcitrant. Do you get a lot of repeat?
We get a lot of persons who fail to obey a civil protection order.
Uh-huh.
And that can come to the attention of the judge in a couple of ways. For example, the victim might notify mm-hmm. us that he's reoffending. He's mm-hmm. contacting me, and you had ordered him not to contact
right.
me. They will notify us, and often it's through a motion to hold the respondent or the abuser in contempt.
They
file this motion with the court.
And they can be helped with filing this when you come to court.
Definitely helped with filing
okay,
it.
Okay, very good.
It's a very consumer-friendly office, one of the best in
very
the country.
Good.
Yes,
very I believe that. DC
yes.
is very far ahead of the country. When
but
it comes
they
to
can't
this.
Prosecute it on their own.
Right.
If they file that motion to hold the respondent in contempt,
mm-hmm.
then I must refer that either to the U.S. Attorney's Office
uh-huh.
or the Attorney General's Office. Usually it's the Attorney General's Office first to see
uh-huh.
if they. Have decided to institute criminal contempt proceedings.
I was going
to
say, it's criminal.
The person could not do that on their own.
Uh-huh.
They can just file the motion and then it's referred.
Uh-huh.
Many times the offices do, you know, pursue that.
Yeah.
Also,
at that point, they can go to jail.
That's right. They could.
Uh-huh.
They face possibly, if convicted, up to 180 days in jail and or a fine of $1,000, and that's for each count.
That's excellent.
If convicted. Now, also, it comes to my attention through the probation office, and
mm-hmm.
they will file what's called an alleged violation report.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a written report, and it says, Judge, he hasn't come in for drug testing.
Mm-hmm.
He's become what's called mm-hmm. a loss of contact person.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so, in those instances, I issue what's called an order to show cause to get the person in.
Into court.
Right. You know, so they can explain themselves.
Explain themselves.
Yes.
Right. Okay, we'll be right back. We have to take another break. I'm sorry. Yes.
1450 WOL, where information is.
Get face-to-face with the artists and celebrities you care about on theurbandaily.com, your source for the latest in entertainment news, interviews, and reviews. The Urban Daily's exclusive videos bring you face-to-face with the biggest names in music, movies, and TV. Our editors scour the web for the newest tracks and latest gossip. Theurbandaily.com gets you face-to-face with what's new, what's now, and what's next. Theurbandaily.com.
What are you going to do with your old car? You can try selling it. You could junk it. Or you can donate it to Heritage for the Blind. Your car will be towed away for free and your donation is tax deductible. Just call 1-800-943-1356. Heritage for the Blind accepts cars, vans, trucks, and boats. It doesn't matter if your vehicle runs or not. It'll be towed away for free and you'll be supporting those that need help. Heritage for the Blind is a nonprofit organization that helps the visually impaired live fuller lives. Call right now to donate your car, and as a special thank you for calling, you'll receive a free 3-day vacation voucher to many exciting locations. Call Heritage for the Blind right now. Call 1-800-943-1356. Donating is easy, and your vehicle is towed away for free. Plus, you'll get a free vacation voucher. Call now. 1-800-943-1356. That's 1-800-943-1356.
McGruff here.
The crime dog?
Yep.
I think I'm gonna need your help. I've got an internet bully.
Okay, well, what you do is...
Maybe you could put a virus on her computer. Or a tracking device. Or a bug.
You don't have to do that, are you?
Or maybe we could get an attack dog. You ever see those attack dogs that can, like, rip a person's arm off? Seriously. Or like a SWAT team. A cyber SWAT team or something. Or like an army. Did you ever see that zombie army movie? We should get a zombie army.
Wait. All you need to do to stop an internet bully is delete their messages and never forward them on.
So, no zombies?
No zombies.
Bummer.
Delete cyberbullying. Don't write it, don't forward it. For more information, visit ncpc.org. A message from the U.S. Department of Justice, Crime Prevention Coalition of America, National Crime Prevention Council, and the Ad Council.
Owning and caring for a home comes with a lot of to-dos. Fix the AC, build a deck, remodel the kitchen. Whatever your home improvement needs, Home Advisor can help you find a pro you can trust to get the job done right. Go to fixitfast.homeadvisor.com for instant access to top-rated pros in your area. And Home Advisor is absolutely free to use. You can read customer reviews of the pros, even use the cost guide to find out what hundreds of other home projects cost in your area. Go to fixitfast.homeadvisor.com to find the right pro for your project.
Elevate your mind. Elevate your spirit at Elevate.com. Discover keys to improve your finances, health and fitness tips, and daily articles to uplift your spirits throughout your day. Build yourself for better living. Enter into serenity. Experience growth. It is all here at Elevate.com. Visit www.elev8.com today. Elevate.com, empowering you.
Life insurance companies are praying you don't learn about the little-known but painfully obvious secret of how to win the game of life insurance so that you win and the insurance companies lose money on your policy. I'll share the secret with you, even if you don't buy your policy from me. I'm Byron Udell of AccuQuote, and since 1986, we've helped millions of people save a fortune on their life insurance. Call AccuQuote today at 800-500-3353 and ask about the secret. That's 800-500-3353.
A message from the Ad Council.
News Talk 1450 WOLAM, where information is power.
Welcome back. This is your host, Attorney Ethel Mitchell. We're in the final part of our program right now. I'm going to do something a little bit different. I'm going to Greater Mount Nebo AME Church in Bowie. They're having their annual Law Day, where they have lawyers and judges last year who come in and they talk about all kinds of different areas of the law. So I'll be there at 11 o'clock. I'll be talking about wills and trust. It's all free. I think you're supposed to pre-register, but there are quite a few of those instances going on. But today is Greater Mount Nebo. On November 12th, I'll be giving a presentation at Unity of Fairfax from 6:30 to 8:30 in the evening, where I'll be talking about estate planning. Today, we're not going to talk about other news because we're going to come back to Judge Sadler, but I did want to announce that on November 23rd, the National Coalition of 100 Black Women will celebrate their 30th anniversary with a luncheon that's chaired by my cousin, Dr. Era Thomas Brown, at the Hilton McLean Tyson Corner. It will be moderated by Maureen Bunyan, and the guest speaker will be Rosalind Brock, who is chairman of the board of directors of the NAACP. Tickets are $75 and can be purchased on Eventbrite at 30th Anniversary Luncheon, or you can call 703-920-1626 or 301-292-9069. So I encourage you to purchase your tickets. I'm sure it's going to be a wonderful affair. Again, that's November 23rd, the 30th anniversary of the National Coalition of 100 Black Women. Now, let's come back to Judge Flanagan Sadler, yes. Judge, what do you want the listening audience and the public, especially those who may be the victims of domestic violence, to know? What are the important points that you want them to know? Because it's important for them to know there is help out here.
Yes. I think there are a lot of misconceptions about domestic violence. I want the listeners to know that at least two things come to mind. Domestic violence doesn't always just involve hitting. It can take a lot of different forms. It can involve belittling or emotionally abusing the victim, threats, spitting on them, destroying their property, physical violence, sexual violence, and a host of other acts. I think a person who threatens or disregards someone else's property rights or personal safety is an abuser, mm-hmm. As anyone else hitting.
Mm-hmm.
The second thing I'd like the listeners to know is that abusers and survivors of abuse don't necessarily look a certain way. We have all types of people from our society. Economic status, mm-hmm. What they look like, gender, mm-hmm. all of that. And each of them, if they believe they are the victim of abuse, should come to the court
and get
redressed.
Yes.
As to advice to individuals who may be interested in obtaining a civil protection order, I would say do so. If you think you've been the victim of domestic violence, if you don't have a lawyer, you can represent yourself, but there are a number of legal organizations in the District of Columbia, Maryland, and Virginia that offer free or inexpensive representation to mm-hmm. survivors of domestic abuse. If you're representing yourself, the Domestic Violence Clerk's Office can assist you with the filing of what's called a petition for civil protection order. The court also has victims' advocates.
Very good.
I often call upon them in the audience when someone doesn't understand quite, you know, what I'm saying. They're mm-hmm. in the audience. They're helpful. We have attorney negotiators. When people come to court, they mm-hmm. may not understand the process, and we have wonderful attorney negotiators who take the person's side, and I'm talking about the alleged abusers and the alleged victims.
Okay.
And they explain what options they have.
Okay.
In clear, concise
layman's
terms.
Layman's terms.
So it's not a place to be feared.
Right.
Come, don't sit, and don't take it.
Right. Good. That's important. Regardless of your ethnicity, regardless of your language,
yes.
regardless of your immigration status, you yes. do not have to live like that. And that's the point that I want people to know, because mm-hmm. the law does give you some relief.
It does.
And would you give the court number where people can just call and get started at least with the process?
Well, to get started with the process, again, as you stated, I would call the main number, 879-1010, and ask for the domestic violence unit. And I do want to stress, this is different than the family court. The domestic
yes.
violence unit is a separate unit. It has both a criminal side and a civil side. This is the domestic violence unit. We deal with family issues sometimes, custody and visitation, but be sure to ask for the domestic violence unit.
Good.
Which is
good.
On the fourth floor.
Fourth floor.
Very uh-huh. helpful clerks
okay.
and assistants.
That's important to know. That's
yes.
important to know. And that stalking is becoming more and more a problem as well as assault. Without striking, is that not correct?
I believe it is true.
Yeah,
definitely
I've heard
correct.
That. I've heard
yes.
that. Yeah,
and especially in this technologically advanced society, where mm-hmm. you can stalk somebody through a text message.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say you text them 100 times a day. That could be harassment.
People do that?
People do that. They call all hours of the day, all hours of the night, and our harassment. Statute is under the stalking statute.
Okay. And, okay. So people can get relief from that from your court.
They can get relief from uh-huh. that. And stalking, as I said before, it doesn't have to involve people who are romantically involved or who even know each other.
Okay.
That's one of the categories
that are allowed. That you. Yeah. That are actionable.
Yes.
Excellent. Excellent. And you don't have to have a lawyer.
You do not have to have a lawyer. I call it consumer friendly. We have
right.
a wonderful domestic violence unit.
Very good.
Yes.
And even if you don't have witnesses or you don't have marks or you don't have bruises, if you have been assaulted, meaning somebody has threatened you, you can get relief.
You can get relief. I tell people you can evidence can be just testimony. And I always tell people I like no other judges. I'm not a human lie detector.
Mm-hmm.
I can't say, well, you lied and you tell the truth.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not a human lie detector, mm-hmm. neither is a jury. So no
right.
fact finder is that, but I make credibility findings.
Okay.
I determine who, if anyone, is more credible.
That's very
and
good.
And so that can be just based on testimony.
Excellent. That's
to
good
fear
to know.
Not
that's important information.
Or documentary evidence.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Judge. Thank you so much.
Thank you for yeah. inviting me.
Thank you very much. Listeners, please remember that this show will be archived on our website, lawtalkwithethelmitchell.com. So you can go there. You can send people there after Wednesday. It should be up. Listen in next week. We're going to have the chair of the Congressional Black Caucus on our program. That is the most powerful, or one of the most powerful groups in our country, fully 10% of the U.S. Congress. And the chair, Representative Marcia Fudge, will be our guest next week. So please tune in next week from 9 to 10. This is Attorney Ethel Mitchell signing off, and have a great week.
You've been listening to Law Talk with Ethel Mitchell. Be sure to tune in next Saturday at 11:30 a.m. for another informative broadcast. To reach Attorney Mitchell, you may do so by calling 202-772-1988. That's 202-772-1988. Or log on to her website, www.lawtalkwithethelmitchell.com. 1450.